Is it a bad idea to use a group in SwiftUI? I found an article that argues this exact point, and because it mentions an edge case of using group that I hadn't previously realized, I figured it would be interesting to talk about it. So let's get into it, and as usual, you have the link to the article in the description. So first, let's start with a recap of what group actually does in SwiftUI. Group is a special view. It's more a wrapper than a view in a sense, because what it does is that it collects multiple views into a single instance without affecting the layout of the views. So it doesn't behave like an HStack or a VStack that does affect the layout. But what group does is that it basically collects all of the modifiers applied to the group and then distributes them onto the views inside the group. So what does it mean? It means that if you create a group like this one and then apply the modifier navigation bar title onto the group, it will be the same thing than if you had applied this modifier individually, both on the welcome view and on the login view. But of course, with the advantage that you've written the code that applies the modifier only once. So with this example, using group seems to be perfectly reasonable. And indeed, when the modifier basically impacts the style of the view, group seems to behave exactly like we want it to. But the thing is, not all modifiers only impact the style. Some modifiers can also implement side effects. For example, modifiers like onAppear. And you can see that the documentation of group, the official doc from Apple, states that the modifier applies to all members of the group and not the group itself, so what we've seen. So for example, if you apply the modifier onAppear to the above group, it applies to all of the views produced by the if is logged in conditional, so right here, and it executes every time is logged in changes. And this behavior could really be something that you don't expect and that creates subtle bugs. Because let's take a look at this other example. We have a function to fetch some data, and the function fetch data is called inside the onAppear modifier applied onto the group. If you look at this code at a glance, you might think that onAppear will only be called when the group is displayed for the first time. But what's gonna happen actually, or rather what used to happen in previous versions of iOS, as we'll see just after, is that this onAppear modifier would be distributed onto all of the subviews, just like any other modifier used on the group. And so this code here would be equivalent to this code here, meaning that fetch data would be called when the progress view appears, as we expect, but also when the data loaded view appears, and that's definitely not what we expect. We are basically calling fetch data one extra time. It's a bug that in the best case would make our backend cost more important because we'd be making twice the amount of queries to the backend, or a bug that could even introduce some subtle issues. You can think, for example, that maybe the user has been doing things that change the state of the UI while fetch data was executing, and then once fetch data would have finished, it would maybe reset some of the UI state properties. So definitely a kind of subtle bug, and I can understand that back in the days when faced with this behavior that even though it was exactly what the doc said might not be what you would expect when seeing the code at a glance, the author came to the conclusion that it was better not to use group at all. But as we're going to see, things have changed a bit with group because now what it appears, according to the test made by the author, that modifiers that implement a side effect, such as onAppear, onDisappear, and task, now have basically been special cased by Apple, and when used on a group, they are applied at the group level and no longer distributed onto the subviews. So you can see this example here, where we have onAppear being applied on the group, and then individual onAppears being applied also on the subviews inside the group. And you can see that the way the code behaves, if you look, it points to the console left, group, and then right. So let's have a look at it. It means that this view's onAppear was called, then the onAppear of the group. The task here in the onAppear triggered a change, a toggle in the isLeft property used in the conditional, which showed the second rectangle. We have print printed to the console, but this onAppear at the group level was not executed again, which means that it was executed only once at the group level and so not distributed onto the subviews. And according to the author, this behavior is present in iOS 26 and seems to have been there as far back as iOS 15. So it seems that the behavior of distributing onAppear, onDisappear, and other side effect modifiers onto the subviews would have been there only in the very first versions of iOS, iOS 13, and maybe iOS 14. But if we scroll a bit below in the article, we can see that the author found a bug report from June 2020, so basically 1 year after the initial release of SwiftUI, which was June 2019, someone had noticed that back then the group view would behave differently whether it was at the top level, so the first thing inside the body, or more nested. And basically, when a group was top level, onAppear and onDisappear modifiers would not be distributed. However, when the group was not top level, they would be distributed. And it seems that Apple fixed this bug by saying that the top level behavior is the behavior that should always happen. So modifiers onAppear, onDisappear, and later task will not be distributed onto the subviews of the group. And so this leaves us with the very weird current situation where the documentation, the official documentation from Apple, explicitly states that all modifiers are distributed onto the child views, including onAppear, which is explicitly mentioned, even though when you look at the behavior, onAppear, onDisappear, and task are not distributed onto the child views. And as if things were not as complex as it is, the author finds that actually, when you have a group that is embedded within a list, then in that case, and in that case only, apparently, you do have the behavior of the onAppear modifier being, in that case, distributed onto the subviews. So here we have the same code than before, except that the group has been wrapped inside a list. And if we have a look, we can see that in the console, we have the pattern left is printed, then group, then right, then group, then left, which shows that indeed we have this onAppear that is distributed on all of the child views, which causes the isLeft Boolean to be toggled left and right, or rather true and false, indefinitely. So that definitely goes to show that group is quite something that you want to be cautious when you use, because its behavior is not obvious until you've actually executed the code. And you can see that the author makes the point of, should you actually use group at all? And here are a few examples of where it might make sense to use group. For example, to distribute style modifiers, but then it begs the question, wouldn't it be easier to actually write the modifiers maybe twice, but at least it's very clear what's happening? That's a good point, to be honest. Then there's also the question when you want to have some kind of, you see here, you have common modifiers and then specific modifiers. That's indeed a potential use case for group, but it also begs the question, isn't this code quite complex, and wouldn't it be better to wrap these different modifiers into like styles with explicit names maybe? And then you've got the last example that you sometimes see in the doc about using group, even though now it's no longer necessary, which is that in the past, inside a VStack, an HStack, or any closure that uses add view builder, you could only declare at the maximum 10 child views. Now this limit isn't present in Swift anymore. So even in that case where you would have had to use group, now you no longer need to use group. So what should you take away from watching this video and reading this article? Should you go back to your code that uses some groups and refactor that code to get rid of the groups? I would say definitely not. If your code is working as you expect it to work, there's no reason to go and change it. Now, what should you do in the future if you're writing code and you see that there's the opportunity to use a group to factor out some modifiers? I must say, I don't have a super strong opinion on this one. If you're using style modifiers and you want to factor them out using a group, I think it's okay most of the time, in the sense that when another developer or yourself in the future will look at the code, you will at the glance very likely understand how the code will behave. Just keep in mind that maybe it might make sense to actually wrap the several modifiers that you want to distribute using a group, maybe in a named modifier, maybe in an explicit style. Maybe that will make things easier while also documenting your code along the way. But where I would indeed advise caution is if you're planning to use a group with one of the modifiers that implement a side effect like onAppear, onDisappear, or task. In that case, because the documentation clearly contradicts the actual behavior, honestly, I would advise caution and not use a group, even if it comes at the cost of having the code be a bit more verbose. I think it will be better both for yourself, but also for the future, because, well, we've seen that AI coding tools are becoming more and more common, and AI coding tools, they rely on the documentation to understand how code behaves. And when you have code that behaves in a different way than what the documentation states, that's something that could definitely introduce issues with the AI agents that might be reviewing your code in the future or writing your code in the future. And that brings me to the final reason why I wanted to make this video, which is that a lot of AI models, when you ask them to generate SwiftUI code, actually love to make an extensive use of groups. And so I felt it was super important for the iOS engineer that will be reviewing this AI generated code to be fully aware of the really subtle gotchas that can be associated with using a group, so that when you review the code, you know exactly what to look out for. And maybe you're also aware that since group can be tricky, well, maybe it might be worth asking the AI to actually rewrite the code without using groups. That's all for this video. I hope you've enjoyed learning about this subtle and very tricky behavior of groups. As always, if you have any feedback on this video, feel free to let me know in the comments. If you've enjoyed the video, don't forget to leave a like and subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss the next ones. Thank you for watching and see you next time.